Let's refresh a couple of dictionary definitions. Democracy is government by all the people. A coup d'etat is a sudden overthrow of a government by force or illegal means. Now, this is exactly what happened in Kiev in February of 2014. A violent coup d'etat overthrowing the democratically elected Yanukovych government in Ukraine. A coup d'etat by definition, no argument. Here is a clip from an Obama press conference a short time later where he is speaking about Crimea.
The proposed referendum on the future of Crimea would violate the Ukrainian constitution and violate international law. Any discussion about the future of Ukraine must include the legitimate government of Ukraine. In 2014, we are well beyond the days when borders can be redrawn over the heads of democratic leaders.
In this press conference, Mr. Obama chooses to refer to the incoming administration as a legitimate government. In terms of democratic principles, clearly, there is no way that you can consider them a legitimate government. He also chooses to refer to them as democratic leaders. Democratic. Now, I can only conclude that Mr. Obama does not understand the principle of democracy, or he's plainly lying. So let's presume that Mr. Obama does understand the principle of democracy. So why then is he lying? Mr. Obama is following a narrative that is consistent with an underlying agenda. And what's the underlying agenda? The underlying agenda is a heist. It's the theft of an entire nation. It's an effort to wrest control or influence of this country away from Russia and bring it into Western control. Our Western leadership and media are lying constantly and misrepresenting the truth on almost every occasion to support this agenda. Mr. Obama's purpose was to overthrow the democratically elected government in Ukraine and replace it with one of his own choosing. It's a regime change. It's a Western criminal enterprise. Here is what Mr. Obama has said recently.
And since Mr. Putin made this decision around Crimea and Ukraine, not because of some grand strategy, but essentially because he was caught off balance by the protests in the Maidan and Yanukovych then fleeing after we had brokered a deal to transition power in Ukraine,
Mr. Obama openly admits that we brokered a deal to transition power in Ukraine. A senior White House administration official has said that Obama's remarks referred to U.S. efforts to help resolve the crisis in the run-up to a February 21, 2014 deal signed by Yanukovych and what was then Ukraine's opposition. But there are a couple of problems with this explanation. Firstly, Obama says that we brokered a deal. Who's the we? One would assume that he means the US, but the February 21 deal was witnessed by representatives of Germany, France, and Poland. The US did not even have a representative there. Perhaps Europe was a little offended by Victoria Nuland's glowing compliments to the EU in her infamous intercepted telephone conversation with Jeffrey Pyatt. The second problem with the White House explanation is that the February 21 agreement did not involve a transition of power. The February 21 agreement involved a return to Ukraine's 2004 constitution, the formation of a national unity government, and guaranteed presidential elections by December of 2014. None of these key elements constitutes a transition of power. So what was Mr. Obama really referring to? I think Mr. Obama has perhaps a little arrogantly and clumsily spilled the beans. I think he's quite amazed with what he can actually get away with. What he was really referring to was a deal brokered by Victoria Nuland with Ukraine's then opposition leaders. Remember in her conversation with Jeffrey Pyatt, they use phrases, glue this thing, the process moving ahead, midwife this thing. What we need is Biden for an attaboy and to get the deets to stick. It is completely obvious to most of us that these two are discussing their plans and arrangements for their post-coup Ukrainian government. The transition of power that Obama is referring to is what we call a coup d'etat. It is the criminal desecration of the principle of democracy. We have another very good example of American democracy in history. It occurred on November 22, 1963. Yet another U.S. transition of power.
It appears as though something has happened in the motorcade route. Something, I repeat, has happened in the motorcade route.
So what's at stake in Ukraine? Russia, together with the BRICS nations, represent an emerging major economic threat to the U.S. and Western economic empire. Russia has enjoyed a substantial period of prosperity since the end of the Soviet era, mostly on the back of oil and gas exports. Russia is the number one resource-rich country in the world. All the sanctions leveled at Russia are designed to blunt or stifle Russia's economic ascendance. But there is another factor of perhaps more importance. Ukraine also is blessed with an abundance of natural resources, not of the same magnitude as Russia, but still a country well worth stealing. Here is a table that I have relatively quickly prepared from online research some 6 months ago. So please take current commodity prices into account for yourself. As you can see, Ukraine possesses reserves of around $9 trillion worth in these four major resources. Ukraine also is blessed with very rich agricultural lands. I have divided the resources into the two broad regions of central and western Ukraine, Kiev, and the south and east, Novorossiya. To provide a background to this, Ukraine is in fact a sharply divided country. It is divided linguistically. The western and central regions are Ukrainian speaking, and the south and east predominantly Russian speaking. If we look at voting results for the 2010 presidential elections, we can see that the west and central regions all voted for Tymoshenko, the south and east strongly for Yanukovych. If we look at this graph of geopolitical orientation in Ukraine, surveyed in January of 2013, we can see that the west and center lean strongly to Europe, and the south and east strongly to Russia. So the solution in Ukraine is really a no-brainer. If we just agree on an amicable divorce along the clearly defined split line, we could achieve peace in Ukraine almost overnight. Let those Ukrainians that wish to become part of Europe realize their European aspirations. And let those Ukrainians that couldn't care less about Europe determine their own future for themselves. But I'm sure you can now see the problem that we face with this obvious solution. 90% of Ukraine's natural resources are in the south and east. So if we do settle on a divorce, Kiev and the Western world will wind up with the poorer half of Ukraine. Here's another table looking specifically at the regions of Donetsk and Luhansk. This region holds some very important resources. The Yuzivska gas field was discovered in 2010, just 5 years ago, and quotes proven reserves of 2 trillion cubic meters. That's nearly $1 trillion worth. Now that would keep Mrs. Merkel nicely warm and toasty in the winter, don't you think? And of course, you can bet that Obama and the Bidens just can't wait to get fracking there. The region also holds the bulk of Ukraine's coal reserves, around 84%. All up, we have $3.6 trillion worth of reserves in this territory. I'd say that's worth killing for. So a peace deal that is based on preserving Ukraine's territorial integrity is not really a peace deal at all. This obsession with preserving Ukraine's territorial integrity masks an underlying motive. It's all about the resources. It's all about the money. Territorial integrity is just lines on maps. We can change them quite easily. Let's not forget that the current Ukraine has only existed since independence in 1991, 24 years. Anyone older than this would have been born in Soviet Russia and would probably consider themselves as Russian. We must also be mindful of the insane paranoia that still grips US decision-making today. Expressed by Brzezinski in 1997, where he wrote, "Without Ukraine, Russia ceases to be empire, while with Ukraine, bought off first and subdued afterwards, it automatically turns into empire." According to him, the New World Order, under the hegemony of the United States, is created against Russia and on the fragments of Russia. Ukraine is the Western outpost to prevent the recreation of the Soviet Union. This outdated Cold War paranoia still pervades the minds of US decision makers today. If we look at this crisis from the perspective of an East Ukrainian, the government that these people voted into office with more than 75% support has been overthrown in a violent coup d'etat. They consider the current administration in Kiev as illegitimate, and rightly so. They have had their democratic rights violated and annulled. And when they objected and voiced their right to self-determination in a vote for independence, their voice has been declared invalid, and they have been labelled as terrorists. And we now have the right to send an army to their territory and exterminate them. We have the right to shell their cities to destruction. We have the right to specifically target civilians, women and children, and the elderly. In fact, anything that breathes. Do we? The Western world can hang its head in shame. We have desecrated every single principle that we imagine in our delusional minds that we hold dear. Sadly, the fact is that by our actions and inactions, we have completely desecrated the principle of democracy. We have completely desecrated the principle of human rights. We have completely desecrated the principle of humanity and life itself. Well done.